This is Panorama. Madeleine McCann. The unseen footage of her parents as the tide of public opinion was about to turn.
Oh, I didn't realise you were there.
Not like there's a textbook about it, is there? Like, what to do when your daughter gets abducted?
Still hard to think. It's us. It's actually happened to us.
And the friend who tried to warn them.
I said to them that I think there's a possibility that Madeleine may not be the story eventually, that you may be the story.
But where will that story end? The police now say they don't expect the long-awaited DNA results to be decisive. But they're not ready to clear the McCanns and want to speak to witnesses again. Tonight, one of them describes to us the moment she believes Madeleine was taken.
I just saw somebody walking across the top of the road, so I was reasonable distance away from them, and that person was carrying a child.
It's a story that's transfixed most of us, but which has largely been told through leaks, spin and innuendo, partly because of the Portuguese justice system. But tonight, Panorama talks to people with first-hand accounts of what happened that night, including a first interview with a woman who says she saw Madeleine being abducted. It comes at a key moment in the investigation, with the police now under pressure to justify the cloud of suspicion over the McCanns. Richard Bilton reports.
From anguish.
Please continue to pray for Madeleine. She's lovely.
To a form of celebrity.
This poster was the one that we did in conjunction with J.K. Rowling for the distribution.
Then doubts.
Hey!
And finally, suspects.
They have both been today declared acquittal.
Their story has been the same from day one. Their daughter was abducted. But they were forced to leave Portugal without her and had to protest their innocence.
Despite there being so much, we wish to say that we are unable to do so, except to say this. We have played no part in the disappearance of our lovely daughter, Madeleine.
Funny, we were having such a good time, just like with our friends and their kids, and I think because it was a group of us, you're into each other, do you know what I mean? You kind of, your interactions with each other, whereas maybe if it had just been me and Jerry and the kids, you know, you probably spend a bit more time looking around, you know.
This is the McCanns at home, being filmed by a friend in August. So far, this footage has remained private. This is the first time it's been seen.
I mean, we're all new to this. It's awful, and you know, it's horrible for anyone to have to go through, and we're just doing what we think's best, and we don't know. We don't know what we're doing's right, you know.
During the making of this film, somebody said to me that the McCanns are either monsters or martyrs. As it stands, I can't tell you what happened to Madeleine McCann on that night. No one seems to be able to do that. But what I can do, with new information, new interviews, with new pictures that have never been seen before and were filmed by the McCanns' friends, is to give you the fullest and clearest account yet of the mystery of Madeleine McCann and why her parents seem unable to shake off the suspicion that they were somehow involved.
We have uncooperative witnesses who don't collaborate. The McCanns and the friends, the people who are there, who clearly aren't collaborating with the investigation.
April of this year, The McCanns, along with a group of friends who all have preschool children, decide to go for an early break in the sun. They come here, to the Ocean Club in Praia da Luz, Portuguese Algarve. Kate McCann calls home. The holiday's going well.
It was good. She said it was cold. She said the weather was cold and they were quite surprised because they hadn't taken a lot of warm clothing. And so she was surprised about that. But I think the day I was speaking to her, it had improved a bit. And I think she said that they were going down to the beach.
The week-long holiday is coming to a close. Day 6 is Thursday, May the 3rd. We've produced this model of the Ocean Club to clearly show the key areas and where people were. The tennis courts and pool area, the tapas bar, and here, apartment 5A, where by 5:30 in the evening, the McCanns say the children have been picked up from their kids' clubs and they're all back together. At 6, Jerry McCann has his third tennis lesson of the day, so he leaves the flat. He says as a family they talked about bringing the children back out to play in the area by the courts. At 6:30, Jerry McCann asks a friend, David Payne, to pop in on Kate to see if the children are coming down. He goes to the flat. He says all is well, but the children are too tired and are already in their pyjamas. At 7, lesson over, Jerry McCann goes back to the apartment. He says he reads the children a story, and all three are asleep by 7:30. The couple say they have a glass of wine before, at 8:30, they leave for the tapas restaurant. It's on the complex about 70 metres away. They'd eaten here every night of their holiday with their friends. They can't see the front or the side of the apartment, but they can see part of the back, though even that view is partially obscured by bushes.
We ate in the open air bit of the tapas, and when we went in, there was, I think, one or two other couples.
And then it was just us, you know, and it wasn't late, you know, it was 8:30 when we met.
One couple we played tennis with, and we chatted to them, and then some of our friends started arriving, and they left shortly after that. And I think at that point we might have been the only table.
Now what follows is a crucial part of this story. The police have told Panorama that the timeline, the chronology of the events of the night of May the 3rd, are still at the heart of this investigation. They say that there are many inconsistencies in what the group who were having dinner with the McCanns, the so-called Tapas Nine, have said in their witness statements. This is what the McCanns say happened that night.
There's a party of nine. It's coming towards the end of their holiday and most people are drinking. All the couples have children in the apartments. They say they took turns to check up on them.
We all knew what we had to do, what we were doing, and you know, it worked. It was a system we had going and it just seemed totally right, you know.
Jerry McCann says he went at just after 9 to check on his children. He says that their bedroom door was more open than usual, so he goes in. Jerry McCann has told Panorama he remembers looking down at Madeleine. He spent a moment thinking how beautiful she looked and how lucky he was. He says this was the last time he saw his daughter. He closes the bedroom door and leaves through these unlocked patio doors. A stair gate, since removed, is shut. This gate is on the latch, not locked. Returning to the tapas bar, he meets Jeremy Wilkins, who he'd played tennis with that afternoon. He crosses the road to talk to him.
I bumped into one guy I played tennis with in the street when I'd gone in to check, and that was the first time, I think, of any of the nights that I'd been going up and down that I saw anyone else, really. 5-6 nights, and it was incredibly quiet.
They spoke for a few minutes. At this time, around 9:15, Jane Tanner thinks about checking on her children.
I think the starters were about to arrive, so I thought I'll go and do a check. It had been sort of 20 minutes or so before we'd last checked. So I'll go and do a check before the food arrives. So I just walked out of the restaurant up the hill. I passed Jerry. He was talking to one of his tennis friends at the time. And then after I'd passed Jerry, at the top of the road, I just saw somebody walking across the top of the road. So I was a reasonable distance away from them. And that person was carrying a child.
And you say a person, male or female?
Oh, a male.
And just describe that individual to us.
It's about probably 5'8" tall. He was taller than me, but not 6 foot, and so between those two. He was wearing quite a lot of clothes, and that's one thing in hindsight, again, I think was quite odd, because tourists, when they're abroad, you know, Brits abroad would always have crop trousers or shorts or something, and he had sort of a big heavy jacket and trousers on. And the hair, the one thing that I remember a lot is the hair. It did seem to have quite a lot of dark, reasonably long to the neck hair.
Describe exactly what he's carrying, what you can see.
Well, I can just see, I could tell it was a child, and I could see the feet and sort of the feet in the bottom of the pyjamas. But I just thought, that child's not got any shoes on, because you could see the feet. And it was quite a cold night in Portugal in May. It's not actually that warm. I know I'd got a big jumper on. And I can remember thinking, oh, that parent's not a particularly good parent. They've not wrapped them up.
And could you tell whether it was a boy or a girl?
Only because the pyjamas had a pinky aspect to them, so you'd presume a girl. It was actually quite cold.
In your sketch, he appears to be carrying the child in a sort of unusual way.
Yeah, I was carrying sort of across the body like that. I suppose in hindsight, you probably think somebody would carry them more against the shoulder.
And I have to ask you this, are you absolutely sure of what you saw? Because a long time ago, and it was only for a brief period.
A brief period, but at the time, I knew what I'd seen. I'd gave that information to the police. And because of the pyjamas, I'm absolutely convinced that is what I saw.
According to the McCann timeline, at about 9:30, Matt Oldfield is the next to check on the children. Remember, Jerry McCann says he had closed the bedroom door, but Matt Oldfield says he finds it open. He doesn't go in the room. He sees the twins but can't see Madeline's bed. Because there's no noise, he assumes everything's okay. At about 10, it's Kate McCann's turn to check on the children. The bedroom door is still open. As she closes it, she feels a draft and knows something is wrong. A shutter on the side of the apartment they couldn't see from the tapas bar is open. Madeline is missing. Kate McCann says she searches the flat 3 times before raising the alarm. Jane Tanner says that by this time, she's already back in her apartment.
I went out to the front door of our apartment, and I saw Rachel came and said, oh, Madeline's gone. And so that was the first that I heard about it. And then I saw Kate and Fiona running around shouting Madeline, and Kate said to me, Jane, Madeline's gone, Madeline's gone. And that was the first that I heard.
What time was that about?
I'm not sure. It'd be 10-ish, around 10-ish.
And now all of a sudden what you've seen?
Yeah, it was as soon as Rachel said to me, Madeline's gone, this person sort of came into my head. I hadn't given it a second thought up to that point, but then this person sort of, I suddenly thought, oh, well, that person was a bit odd. Suddenly Madeline's not there, and I've seen somebody that then you think, oh, that maybe was a bit odd. It just seems too much of a coincidence.
The McCanns say they ask Matt Oldfield to call the police at 10:15 from the Ocean Club front desk. When the police don't appear, they say someone from the group goes back to the front desk to see what's happening. The police say the first call they receive was about 10:40. In the chaos, it's clear there is some confusion about the exact times. Remember, Portugal and Britain are on the same time.
I have spoken to someone who was staying very close to flat 5A on the night of May the 3rd. She says the first that she was aware of a missing child was 10:30, and she's sure of that because she says the BBC 10 o'clock news had just finished. She says that she heard Kate McCann sobbing, repeating over and over again, "We've let her down." She also says that she heard the first Portuguese policeman arrive, and he said she must have walked out because there's no sign of a break-in.
Initially, the flat isn't treated as a crime scene, and police would later be criticised for not sealing it off.
There had been quite a few people in the apartment, but not into the bedroom. That was limited to myself, Kate, I think two of our friends, the two GNR officers, and I think the translator. I was certainly saying to people to stay out of the room. There was no sealing off of the room, and the twins were still sleeping in their cots. So we tried to leave it as undisturbed as possible. And they slept very soundly until we moved them out of the cots into the other apartment. Which does make me wonder about whether there was any substances used to keep them asleep.
The police didn't follow this up with tests. Meanwhile, late on May the 3rd, the McCanns begin calling home.
I think it would be about 11:30, and I'm guessing now, I might be wrong. There was a phone call, and it was Jerry on the phone, and he said, it's a disaster, it's a disaster. And he was quite hysterical.
He's absolutely uncontrollable. He's howling and screaming down the phone. They've taken her, she's gone.
He was walking the streets of Praia da Luz at 3:30. I think most of the search party had disbanded by then. And he was still crying his eyes out.
What was Kate like? What sort of state was she in?
She was distressed, obviously. She just asked me if I had the telephone number of Father Paul Seddon. Paul Seddon is a friend of theirs who's a Catholic priest who actually married Jerry and Kate and baptised Madeleine. And for some reason, at that stage, Kate needed to make contact with Paul. She needed the strength that comes from having faith.
We texted a couple of times, just, pray for us, pray for Madeleine.
By dawn, a major search of the whole resort is underway. These officers are from the GNR, the Uniform Portuguese Police, but it's the investigation branch, the Polícia Judiciária, or PJs, who are now in charge of the hunt for Madeleine McCann.
We would again like to appeal for any information, however small, that may lead to the safe return of Madeleine.
First appeals are made, but what we didn't know at the time was that some Portuguese detectives are already telling Portuguese journalists that they don't believe the McCann story.
Information started circulating from sources connected to the Portuguese police that the story was full of holes from the side of the McCanns and their friends.
Indeed, within 2 days of Madeleine disappearing, this crime correspondent was filing this piece in the Portuguese daily Diário de Noticias, headlined, A Badly Told Story.
We started to receive information according to which the police suspected the theory. They had apprehensions, didn't believe the theory that she had been kidnapped. To conclude, the police started to suspect the parents from the word go.
But that breakdown in trust worked both ways. The McCanns quickly grew impatient at the police response.
It seemed bloody slow at the time, and I don't know. I mean, again, you've got to put it into perspective. It's a quiet, sleepy place, certainly that time of year. There's no local police. So they have to come from the nearest town. The local police come out. You've got to remember, we had the language barrier as well.
Against the police advice, the wider McCann family turned to the media. But within days, Kate and Jerry McCann found themselves being judged by the media.
Madeleine is a beautiful, bright, funny and caring little girl. She is so special. Please, please do not hurt her. Please don't scare her. Please tell us where to find her.
It was reported that police suspicions were fueled by the couple's behaviour, that in these early appearances, Kate McCann seemed too cold, too controlled.
We need our Madeleine. Sean and Emily need Madeleine, and Madeleine needs us.
They are criticised for having displayed a cold and calculating attitude throughout this process. You can see already after the kidnapping, Kate McCann appeared on a veranda in front of the journalists, crying purposefully. And we interpreted this as a performance for the media. And this made us feel some sort of discomfort.
Please give our little girl back. Por favor, devolve a nuestra menina.
They were getting advice, if you're too tearful, you're going to have the emotional impact, but you're not going to get the message over. And yes, what comes out of their mouths sounds measured, controlled, and, you know, a nice tempo. They don't speak like that normally. That is a false situation, okay? And they had to work damn hard to get to that place. Because the number of tears that were shed before they went out there, because I saw that, I was backstage there.
And it's in this atmosphere that a former PJ detective goes on Portuguese television and, without any corroboration, accuses the McCanns of being swingers.
There are people who guarantee that this is a couple who practice swinging, i.e. sexual relationships between couples and then changing partners, and that this practice would allow, in this type of situation...
When you say there are people who say, I'm assuming you are quoting...
People who know, obviously. I cannot reveal the source here, because I would lose it.
The Portuguese police publicly disowned the allegation, also denied by the McCanns, but such stories are damaging. Then, within weeks, at a press conference in Germany, this question to the McCanns.
How do you deal with the fact that more and more people seem to be pointing the finger at you, saying the way you behave is not the way people would normally behave if their child is abducted, and they seem to imply that you might have something to do with it?
To be honest, I don't actually think that is the case. I think that's a very small minority of people that are criticising us. You know, we are very responsible parents and we love our children so much, and I think it's only a very few people that are actually criticising us.
That question seemed extreme at the time, but there was more and more focus on Kate and Jerry McCann.
You got the car key there, Jerry?
But one film crew was welcome. The resulting footage wasn't offered to Panorama, but the McCanns agreed to release it to us when word of its existence leaked out.
How do you know the McCanns?
I know them through my wife, Michelle, who was Kate's longest friend. I mean, they met each other back in primary school and have stayed lifelong mates.
John Corner is a film producer. He's also godfather to the McCann twins. The McCanns say because he's a friend, he's invited to make a film for the launch of a YouTube channel for missing children. And on August the 1st, he arrives on the Algarve.
It's very low-key, very relaxed, and very quickly got used to us hanging around.
He films the McCanns for a week. The family have just moved to their new base, a villa on the outskirts of Luge.
You can see the twins are just playing, you know, and you can see it's a normal house. You've got toys and stuff on the floor, and what's quite poignant about it is that you see a father sitting on his own in his bedroom in a foreign country desperately looking for his daughter, and seeing that quite upset me.
Looking at these in isolation I don't find too bad, but when you see videos or the pictures that I haven't seen of her for a while, the common ones I think I've become a bit desensitised to, but the ones that haven't been used as much are much more difficult to look at, and particularly video.
When John Corner arrives at the villa, Kate tells him about Jerry taking his sister and brother-in-law to the airport.
Jerry took them, yeah, he's a bit crumbly, I think. I think he was all right, and then he said, right, I'm going to go now, and then he lost it. And I got a text from Trish, and it said, nearly choked on me full English because of that tiny tears husband of yours, you know. Oh, oh. But, yeah. And,
Is he big brother or little brother?
Little brother, yeah. Jerry's the youngest, yeah.
He's the youngest, yeah. Of course. Because the media see Jerry as this kind of emotionless warrior. He's not really, is he?
No, he's not. I mean, it's really harsh to say that because, I mean, you know, Jerry's always been a very focused person. He's enthusiastic, he's focused, and he's incredibly positive, which is great for me, to be honest. And he's obviously used to speaking in public, to say, not dealing with media, but speaking in public. So he's able to go on and do that and throw himself into it, you know, and I think that's what people see. And, you know, people say, oh, how can you do that? Or how can you stand there and do that when your daughter's being taken and everything? And I mean, I've been like that before, you know, and there's been other cases of kids that have been taken or killed or whatever, and you think to yourself, how does anyone cope with that? How could you get through another day? And then you throw it back to yourself and think, how did I get up this morning? How did I get a shower? How did I get my breakfast? And something obviously gets you through it, apart from the first few days, which you have total sort of physical shutdown, but something gets you through it, you know what I mean? And I think until you're in that situation, you just can't say. You know, he has his lows as well, you know, for sure. And in fact, probably Jerry's lowest points were often on a Saturday because we had like a family day. We just say, right, we'll try and put the work on hold as much as you can, and we'll do something with the twins. And he often found that the hardest because we were having family time without Madeleine, you know, it just didn't seem right.
Because you're their friend, people might treat these pictures with some scepticism. Mm. What difference do you think it made that you were their friend? Were you, for example, guiding them off camera?
Not at all. I was never guiding them off camera. And it's not that kind of relationship with Kate and Jerry. I just let the cameras run, and we burnt a lot of tape. Just let the cameras run.
There'll be plenty of people who won't buy that. This was their friend filming what they wanted seen. But their supporters would say they weren't then suspects. And if they were hiding an extraordinary secret, is it likely the couple would invite a camera team, however friendly, into their lives?
See you later.
I said to them that I think there's a possibility that Madeleine may not be the story eventually, that you may be the story.
What did they say?
They were quite distressed by that, really.
It had not occurred to them before.
Well, it's difficult for me as a friend to be negative and to impart some sense of negativity.
He was right to sense a change. On the day filming was due to start, the police arrive at the McCann villa. As these pictures show, they would return.
They took most of their clothing. They were taking even the wet clothes out of the washing machine. I was aware that the cuddle cat was boxed up, and we were asked to leave the villa.
The crew?
Everybody.
So they searched the whole villa?
Yes.
So what, as all this is going on, what do Kate and Jerry make of this?
Well, this is the bizarre thing, Richard, because the police said to Kate and Jerry, yeah, we're going to be coming along, we want to do some forensics. And Kate and Jerry were massively optimistic about this. And you've got to remember, if your daughter's missing and the police phone you and say, we want to do some forensics, that's a straw that you hang on to. That's a moment for optimism.
That's because the McCann say this was a time when they were pushing for more urgency in the investigation. The Portuguese had rejected their request for the FBI to come in, but they did bring in a British forensic team with sniffer dogs. Kate McCann talks to John Corner as all this is going on.
We're just doing absolutely everything we can do, you know, to help find Madeleine, and the last thing we want is to look back and think we could have done more.
But they're taking clothing away, they're taking the diary away, they're taking cuddle cat away. Were they not thinking things have changed here?
No, I was thinking...
This seems really all a bit late in the day to me.
Let me take you back to what it was like then. I was here in Praia da Luz for BBC News. Like the rest of the media, I was reporting on the 100 days since Madeleine McCann had disappeared. But things were changing. Forensic teams had found what were thought to be specks of blood in the McCann apartment. Those sniffer dogs had reportedly reacted to the scent of death in the McCann hire car and on Kate McCann's clothing. People were starting to think what had previously seemed unthinkable. And faced with all of this, the McCanns agreed to talk to me.
Part of this inquiry is now shifting from a possible abduction to an investigation that might involve death or murder. Were you aware of those sorts of shifts?
We're not naive, but on numerous occasions, the Portuguese police have assured us that they were looking for Madeleine alive and not, Madeleine being murdered. And I don't know of any information that's changed that. Kate and I strongly believe that Madeleine was alive when she was taken from the apartment. Obviously, what we don't know is what happened to her afterwards, who's taken her and what her motive is. And we're desperate to find that out.
And as Jerry's just said there, even last week when we met with the police, they said we are looking for a living child. And they've said that a lot, so.
Yeah.
What I know now, but didn't know then, is that that was precisely the time when the McCanns first experienced a more aggressive attitude from Portuguese police. At an informal briefing, two detectives turned on Kate McCann. She was on her own, Jerry McCann wasn't with her, but her version of events was openly questioned.
I do know afterwards she was incredibly upset, and that was the start of a very difficult period. And I, really felt for them actually, because they went through a very tough time.
And by now, the forensic work is shaping the case. The police doubts are more serious. On Thursday, the 6th of September, Kate McCann is dropped off in Portimão. She's been called in for questioning. Her sister-in-law, Trish, goes to support her. Justine McGuinness, the McCann publicity manager at the time, is also there.
I have to say, I was incredibly impressed, because she just held her head high and walked into the police station and just kept on going. And a lot of people wouldn't have been able to have coped going through a media mob.
As Kate McCann sits down in the interview room, she recognises one of the detectives.
They'd had a meal with this guy, with his family, and the children had played together. And she talked to me about this particular police officer as being, as if he was a friend. And she felt quite comforted by having this guy who spoke English as well. And he was in the interview, and he didn't make eye contact with Kate at all.
Kate McCann is at the station for 13 hours, but from inside, she and Trish text out updates. Even at this point, the message is being controlled.
We were a bit naughty, because we did have messages coming out of the police station, which we weren't supposed to.
Well, the text messages?
Yeah.
And what the text saying? Talk us through
that. Sort of updates on things that were happening.
I'd like to read a statement on Kate's arrival at the police station.
Knowing, everybody had copy to write, had the 10 o'clock news like you did, whatever, the various different deadlines that they had, I felt that it was important just to manage people's expectations.
She finally gets out at 1 o'clock in the morning. Her lawyer tells family and friends what has been put to her by the police.
Kate foi ouvida como testemunha. As diligências de investigação, obviamente, vão continuar a decorrer. E, como bem sabem, o segredo de justiça impõe-no que nada mais digamos.
I mean, there was an allegation put to Kate that she'd been involved in harming her daughter. A dreadful allegation to be put to any mother.
At 3 in the morning, after Kate McCann has returned to her villa, her lawyer arrives with what seems to be a deal. Plead guilty to manslaughter and escape with only 2 years in jail. As he explains the offer, Philomena McCann is on the phone to her sister Trish.
Trisha hands out with a mobile, and there I am listening to Kate screaming at the lawyer, "No! No!" And just the emotion and the disgust, her tone, everything that was being conveyed. I mean, what she was saying, the anger, you could feel it.
This was a turning point.
Kate.
A dramatic 48 hours.
Kate.
First, they're named as official suspects.
Kate and Jerry McCann. They have both been today declared acquitted with no bail conditions.
Then they decide the time has come to leave Praia da Luz, to go home without Madeleine. Few are putting up yellow ribbons now. It's a case that divides people. Those who think that somehow the McCanns are involved, and those who don't, including a small number of wealthy supporters who appoint a legal coordinator.
It was quite clear when Kate and Jerry came back to the UK that they were subject to an open season of abuse in the media. They'd obviously gone through the tragedy of having the daughter taken in very unfortunate circumstances. And to make matters infinitely worse, we're now subject to a trial by media.
So, what exactly is the case against the McCanns? Well, some of it is tenuous, to put it mildly, and had to disentangle from wild press speculation. It was widely reported, for example, that the body was shifted in the back of this vehicle, a Renault Scenic the McCanns hired 25 days after Madeleine disappeared. The story goes that they drove the car to Huelva in Spain on the 3rd of August, where they disposed of the body. According to the McCanns, these pictures show the only trip they made to Huelva.
Bizarre. Truly bizarre. I mean, we used it as a base for the crew.
So that, effectively, is evidence, isn't it? Because that is this trip to Spain, when, if reports are to be believed, in the back of that vehicle is the body of Madeleine McCann.
In the back of that vehicle was a lot of posters of Madeleine and me and my cameraman. It's quite sickening, really, the speculation around what was a genuine trip out to Spain to try and raise public awareness about Madeleine. This is a couple who are desperately looking for their missing daughter. The thought of them having Madeleine in the car is just obscene.
We are told the police do remain interested in this car. One source says it's a mystery why the vehicle does so many miles when Kate and Jerry McCann have left it behind on trips across Europe. There is a new man in charge of the case, and they say everything's being reassessed, and the speculation and police leaks do seem much reduced. We've had access to a thorough briefing from a source close to the top of the Policía Judiciaria. He tells us that two very different scenarios are now being tested. One, that Madeleine was abducted, as her parents believe, or that she died in apartment 5A as a result of an accident and that her death was covered up. And that second theory asks serious questions of the McCanns and their friends. So, let's have a closer look at some of those police suspicions. Now, a senior detective has told us that the friends are everything, that there are inconsistencies in their statements, that they might be hiding something. Specifically, the police thought seems to be that, with the statements as they stand, that night seems so busy it's hard to see a predatory paedophile taking the risk. Officially, the PJ can't talk about this case, but close to the investigation is a PJ detective who also heads the organisation representing Portuguese detectives.
O que se passou naquela noite, num jantar, no final de um jantar...
What happened that night in the dinner? At the end of the dinner in the tapas bar, and everything that happened that night, what was said between those people, it leaves us somewhat perplexed in the way, as I've been saying since the beginning, that not all their statements match up exactly with each other.
Não batem certo uns com os outros. Há...
There are some things where between what one says and what the other says, they don't match up with each other.
Well, if you ask nine people about an events of a night, you're probably going to get nine slightly different stories, and you're not clock watching, you're not, you know, we were having a meal, you're not...
Jane Tanner is the only one of the group of friends who has agreed to speak to us. She denies recent reports that both she and her partner want to change their witness statements.
I know that you've not spoken to the media before, and yet you've been, you know, much discussed. Why have you chosen to speak?
Because
now?
We were, well, for, I've not spoken because the Portuguese police told us not to talk about the case at all. And, you know, from day one, we've done everything we can to help them with the investigation. I think maybe I'm talking now because I'm being called a liar and fantasist and all this, and I know what I saw, and I think it's important that people know what I saw because, you know, I believe Madeleine was abducted.
One reason why the police may doubt the consistency and the honesty of some of the witnesses relates to the first man to be declared our Guido, Robert Moret. In July, here at Portimao PJ headquarters, Robert Moret came face to face with these three people. Russell O'Brien, Rachel Oldfield and Fiona Payne, all part of the McCann holiday group. Invited to read out their statements one by one, they all said they'd seen Robert Moret in and around the Ocean Club on the night Madeleine disappeared. He denied it then, and he denies it now.
Robert is sticking to his guns. He was not there on that night. There is not a shred of evidence against him being there on that night. So, you know, that question definitely needs to be answered. Why are they putting a finger at Robert?
He's been told not to speak to the media, but he wants his views to be heard. As I interviewed his mother and aunt, he sat in on the interview.
What do you think, Jenny?
I guess they don't understand why they're lying. Well, on May the 3rd, I've been out on the taking the dogs out, which I do every single night of my life. And I got home about 8 o'clock, and Robert was already there, and he was in all the evening.
How are you so sure?
Because we were sitting in the kitchen talking the whole evening.
And you would have known if Robert had gone out?
Yes, I definitely would have known if he'd gone out.
Robert Moret was questioned for 3 days, and he remains an arguido. Our access to police briefings points to another area of concern, Kate McCann's journal.
Kate was very distressed, obviously. Every evening, people were having to kind of hold it together, you know, because as bedtime came, it was another day gone, and they didn't have Madeleine back. And so she needed support at that time of the night. And I think it was during that time that Philomena suggested, Kate, why don't you start to keep a journal? And then when Madeleine comes back, you can let Madeleine read it.
Kate McCann's diary will be as important to the investigation as is all the small evidence that has been found throughout the whole course of investigation. Not more, not less. By combining all of the evidence, we will be able to reconstruct what happened that moment, that evening.
There were newspaper claims that Kate McCann had described Madeleine as hyperactive. But we can almost certainly dismiss these. Even the Portuguese Attorney General says that those claims are untrue. Nonetheless, we have been told by detectives that the journal remains of interest. Now, point three for the police, the DNA. As it stands, the full DNA evidence that is being assessed in Birmingham is still not back in Portugal. We understand evidence has been recovered from the underside of the carpet lining in the boot of that scenic. Fluid and hair from a corpse, not necessarily human, and a separate DNA sample that's a partial match from Madeleine and comes from a primary source. Our senior Portuguese contact has said the partial results that have been sent are inconclusive and that he doesn't expect the full set will ever be enough on its own to bring a case, a view shared by those familiar with the investigation.
What did come to Portugal were not conclusive results, but rather said to be indicative. Also, the results from some of the tests are still missing. And these are once again not conclusive results, but rather indicative. To be able to say with certainty that Maddie was there, or that this DNA was Maddie's, the test results would have to be 99% positive. If they are not 99% certain, it can be viewed as indicative, but not conclusive. And if it is not conclusive, the police or the courts should not make any statements at the moment, because they could be wrong.
The McCann's legal team has told us the results of its own tests on the car, conducted by experts, which reveal, they say, nothing incriminating. Our police sources say they have other evidence, which the media knows nothing about. But much of what the police have said and have leaked only points to suspicions about the abduction theory. So, the police say they have no alternative but to continue to investigate the chronology of the events of the night of May the 3rd. Well, let's have a look at the timeline again. The police say there are inconsistencies in the McCann party's version of events. So does the alternative theory that some or all were involved hold any more water? Remember, the McCanns say they picked up their children from the kids' clubs and returned with them to their apartment. At 6, Jerry McCann left for a tennis lesson. Kate McCann stayed indoors with the children. And it's claimed that David Payne looked in at 6:30 and confirmed they were okay. Jerry McCann finished tennis and joined them from 7 to 8:30. If they were solely responsible for something that happened in that flat, that would leave them little more than an hour to clear up and move Madeleine's body. Now, what if something happened when Jerry McCann came back to the flat at just after 9 p.m. to check on the children, as he said he did? Well, that would leave him with even less time. Now, what if there was a third person involved? If that's true, and some detectives think it might be, then it gets more complicated, because this person would be able to move the body any time up until 10 o'clock, when we know the alarm was raised. Those are the theories. But the reality is, we would have to accept that Kate and Jerry McCann, having just been involved in the death of their daughter, then got ready for a night out, were first at the table, and then had a meal with friends, as if nothing had happened. As late as last week, a senior officer was still saying that it's possible the McCanns could have masked their feelings when they were at that meal.
If Madeleine had an accident in Kate's presence, Kate is a doctor, for goodness sake. They were on holiday with doctors. The first thing she would have done would have been to have sought help for Madeleine. You know, it's absolutely ridiculous to think that Kate would do anything else.
In the footage provided to us by John Corner, he revisits the apartment, for some of the time accompanied off camera by Jerry McCann. He tests how easy it would have been for an abductor to get in and out with Madeleine.
Okay, we're sitting at the table. We're sitting at the very table. We can still see the apartment quite clearly. We've got a good line of sight.
We were looking at the back of the apartment, and maybe the weak spots were at the front. And it's very, you know, a corner flat with trees overlooking it. Somebody could be hiding there or watching out of view.
So you see Jerry coming out the gate. And you can see them sitting in the tapas bar.
They've been watching us over a matter of days, I'm sure. They must have known, you know, that Jerry had just been into the apartment, and then you're right, there was only a small window of opportunity, but, you know.
Let's go back to that moment. At about 9:15, Jerry McCann says he's just left the flat. He's still in the street talking to a friend, when Jane Tanner walks past him on the other side of the road up the hill and sees what she now believes to be Madeleine, so at most a window of 5 minutes for someone to get in. The alternative view, which Jerry McCann says was put to him by the police, is that the abductor was already in the flat hiding when Jerry McCann did his checks.
Just even standing here now, I think it's quite creepy because you could just be standing here just chilling out, couldn't you? Just...
You could have been down there.
Do you reckon? So how long would it take us to get across there? 20 seconds?
20 seconds, 10, 16?
Yeah.
Open the window in, out. You'd be having it all done in under a minute.
There was a window of opportunity. And that's the regret that we'll always have. A window of opportunity to snatch a child. And I've no doubt that Madeleine was targeted. And that makes us, you know, sick to the core to think that somebody was watching us and our daughter and had targeted her. And I think the true want is, you know, a predator.
So this is the front door of the apartment, and of course you've got it straight onto the street. So you're straight over the wall onto the street, or straight out there onto the street.
Painfully, for some, the more the couple disclose about how insecure the flat was, the less wise their decision appears to leave the children unattended.
Well, I have to say that I'm surprised that Kate and Jerry left their children at all. And I've thought about it a lot because they're such caring parents. And I think, why?
Clearly, at the time, we felt what we were doing was quite responsible. If we were going to be dining further away or round the corner, we would never have left the kids. And with hindsight, everything with hindsight, it's all taken in the context of your child being abducted. And if we could turn back the clock in that, it'd be, you know, we'd just rewind as fast as we could, completely.
I mean, there isn't a day that goes by that I'm not kind of thinking to myself, why did I think that was okay? You know, was I wrong in thinking that was okay? And, you know, I mean, all I can say to myself is I know how much I love my children. I know I'm a responsible parent, and I know that, you know, and I've just got to keep saying that to myself, really, you know. And
one possibility, and it's no more than that, is that police suspect some of the group of friends may have exaggerated the extent of their checks to make them and the McCanns appear more responsible. If true, it could have inadvertently raised suspicions of something much worse.
They said that every half an hour they would go and look in on the children, and all of them, we found in everybody's statement, some questions that suggest that actually they didn't go and see the children.
It's not about us, you know, we were bobbing back and forward several times an hour to see the kids, so, you know, it's not about us. You know, I think that the problem is it's this predator, basically, who's been watching us, which gives you the shivers anyway, and broken into the apartment and taken Madeleine out of the bed.
So, 200 days on, where is the search for Madeleine McCann now? Well, the two camps are preparing for the next stage. Though we have been briefed by the Portuguese police, they can't speak on television about their view of this case. It's the same for the McCanns, but they have a substantial team working with them, and in the last week they have authorised cooperation with this programme. Briefings, that interview with Jane Tanner, a chance to push their view that Kate and Jerry McCann are innocent.
Part of the reason why we're here disclosing evidence to you today, as opposed to keeping our powder dry, is a recognition that there were two strands to this case. Part of it is the criminal case, but part of it is the media speculation and the media perception. And we see it as incumbent upon us to portray the truth to the media, and in particular, to try and expunge any ill-founded theories about Jerry and Kate's involvement, so that the media attention can focus back onto the abduction, and therefore onto the fact that we have a missing little girl out there.
The police say they are keeping an open mind about this, but will ask to re-interview the McCann's friends again. The delay, we're told, is down to bureaucracy.
Let's say it's important for all the people who were at the Ocean Club in the group, the friends of the McCanns, including the McCanns, to tell us exactly everything that happened, everything they remember.
We've got nothing to hide. We just said what happened. And I don't understand how they can say that doesn't add up, because we've, you know, we've just said what happened on the night.
And that has been widely reported now, but also throughout, this idea that you want to go back and change your story.
It's just complete lies. I mean, I don't know where these stories come from. We've never been in contact with the police to say we want to change our story.
So you said you're prepared to answer questions.
Yeah.
In some ways, would you like to?
I'd love to, yeah. I think I actively want to be re-interviewed. If there is a feeling that what we're saying is wrong, you know, I'll be interviewed, but, you know, then we can clarify that it's not wrong, you know, we're not making things up, it's just what happened.
Have you been ever asked to return to be questioned?
No.
Would you be prepared?
Yes, yeah, of course we would. Yeah, I mean, you know, if it helps to find Madeleine, we'll be interviewed tomorrow, you know, we're obviously key witnesses.
The McCann camp say they continue to cooperate with the police, but they're doing more than that. If there is to be a breakthrough, it may well come through this office, the M3 Detective Agency in Barcelona. It runs this phone number for sightings and information from the public. As part of the McCann's cooperation with this film, they've revealed to us what they believe is a new lead.
Maddie was alive 2 days after the kidnapping. Madeleine was in a car and she was given to another person inside Portugal. We have the description of the woman and the man involved.
We have seen no proof that this is a genuine development, but they're confident of this evidence and say it's been passed to the Portuguese police.
I'm not saying maybe, no. We are very, very close to find the kidnapper.
Do you beat yourself up on this? Is it something you play with in your head? Or?
I do, and I mean, initially I did more, but I just have to think, you know, it's the least thing you'd ever think in a million years that, you know, a child is going to be abducted in a safe family resort. As I said before, Jerry was standing out the other side of the apartment, so I thought Madeleine had just been checked. So there's absolutely no reason why I would think it was odd. You know, there's no reason why I would think it was Madeleine being taken at that point.
More than 6 months on, and there is still only one real fact, and that is Madeleine McCann disappeared on the night of May the 3rd, 2007, and has not been seen since. Now, potentially, the month ahead is crucial. Barring any other developments, the forensic evidence may force the police here in Portugal to decide once and for all if the McCanns are to face any charges. If they do, then they'll have the chance to clear their name. If they don't, then Kate and Jerry McCann could face the rest of their life without their daughter, but with the suspicion that they were involved in her disappearance. Coming soon on Panorama, the battle for Basra Palace, the unheard story of Britain's deadly struggle for southern Iraq, and the legacy we leave behind.
Panorama returns in 2 weeks' time at the usual time of 8:30 here on BBC One.